السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه، وبعد. We are continuing with سورة الحج. We finished with ayah number 33 and we are going to resume tonight from ayah number 34. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ولكل أمة جعلنا منسكا ليذكروا اسم الله على ما رزقهم من بهيمة الأنعام فإلهكم إله واحد فله أسلموا وبشر المخبتين الذين إذا ذكر الله وجلت قلوبهم والصابرين على ما أصابهم والمقيم الصلاة ومما رزقناهم ينفقون والبدن جعلناها لكم من شعائر الله لكم فيها خير فاذكروا اسم الله عليها صواف فإذا وجبت جنوبها فكلوا منها وأطعموا القانع والمعتر كذلك سخرناها لكم لعلكم تشكرون لن ينال الله لحومها ولا دماؤها ولكن يناله التقوى منكم كذلك سخرها لكم لتكبروا الله على ما هداكم وبشر المحسنين. Back ayah number 34. For every community we have set out rituals. We have made rituals. ولكل أمة جعلنا منسكا. Every nation has its own system of laws and rules to follow. When it comes to ibadah, it is called mansak. Also, mansak or nusuk is used to highlight sacrifices. And nusuk هي الأضحية. والنسك هو الشعيرة. لكل أمة جعلنا منسكا ليذكروا اسم الله على ما رزقهم من بهيمة الأنعام. So the way to show your thanks and gratitude to Allah for what He provided you of farm animals is to sacrifice and to give away whatever you have of rizq, part of it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَإِلَهُكُمْ إِلَهٌ وَاحِدٌ فَلَهُ أَسْلِمُ. What is the relationship here between this statement, your ilah, your God is one, submit to him? What is the relationship between this statement and the statement before? The relationship is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who provided, is the one that you worship. The one you sacrifice for is the one you submit to. And as you submit in your sacrifice, you should submit in your worship only to Allah. We understand the importance and significance of this relationship when we put this discussion in the context of the revelation itself. People in Mecca, they kept some of the rituals that they inherited from their forefathers. And their forefathers inherited it from their own forefathers and ancestors up to Ismail and Ibrahim alayhim as-salam. So part of this was the Hajj, the keeping up with the Hajj, the keeping up with the sacrifice. So here Allah saying, the one that you sacrifice for is the only one who is worthy of worship. فَإِلَهُكُمْ إِلَهٌ وَاحِدٌ. How could you sacrifice for Allah and worship the idols? It's inconsistent. So the relevance is clear when you understand the context in which this ayah was revealed. Then فَلَهُ أَسْلِمُ. Very deep and broad concept. To submit means to obey Allah with love. No hesitation, no reluctance. And to submit to Allah with your obedience and to surrender to Allah with everything that He has given you. Whether it is animals you sacrifice, or money you donate, or time you volunteer, or effort you put, whatever, submit to Allah, surrender this back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَلَهُ أَسْلِمُوا وَبَشِّرِ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. Give good news and glad tidings to those who do well. الإحسان is a higher level than justice. In the context of ibadah, al-ihsan is a higher level than performing the duties. So al-ihsan in salah, for example, is to worship with devotion, sincerity, dedication, love, and care. So you care for the details, you care for your wudu, you care for your cleanliness, you care for the direction to the qibla, you care for everything. The same applies to our fasting, that we pay attention to the details. So part of ihsan is to do well what you are going to do, and part of ihsan is to pay attention to the details, and part of ihsan is to have your focus, to be mindful of what you are doing to benefit from it. So in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, لَيْسَ لِلْمَرْءِ مِنْ صَلَاتِهِ إِلَّا مَا عَقَلَ مِنْهَا. Nothing benefits the person who is praying except the part of which he was mindful. So when he said Alhamdulillah, he meant it. When he said Iyyaka na'bud, you only we worship, he really meant it. When he said Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim, guide us to the straight path, he was ready to follow the straight path. So this is the level of care that gives us the benefit of worshiping Allah with ihsan. Ihsan, however, is not limited to how we worship Allah in the formal context, like prayer and fasting and this and this. Ihsan goes to people. Ihsan goes to the rest of life. How you organize your life, how you clean your home, how you treat your children, how you express your love and appreciation for your family, how you take care of them, how you set your priorities and pay attention to details. All of this also is involved. Jazakallahu khairan. Ahsanallahu ilayk. Hatha min al-ihsan. This is part of ihsan, yes. See, my eyeglasses is not working for me. Jazakallahu khair. So, وبشر المخبتين. In this ayah, not al-muhsineen. But let me continue with ihsan since we delved into it. الإخبات نوع من الإحسان. الإخبات is full devotion and dedication that is accompanied and wrapped in humility. الإخبات. So when someone submits to Allah and acts to please Allah, he is not busy with anything else. He is dedicated to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So al-ikhbat is a kind of ihsan. Al-ihsan is a broader meaning under which you can list qanit or qunut, ikhbat, khushu', all of the other, taqwa, it's all of those meanings that are part of ihsan. And this is why in the hadith, the famous hadith of Jibreel, Jibreel asks the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, أخبرني عن الإسلام, أخبرني عن الإيمان, أخبرني عن الإحسان. Tell me about إحسان. If there is a single word to capture the meaning of إحسان, it would be perfection or excellence. How to excel in your life is إحسان. So وبشر المخبتين, الإخبات is to be humble in your submission and devoted in whatever you do. وبشر المخبتين. And the definition of إخبات is whatever touches your heart of whatever good you do. الذين إذا ذكر الله وجلت قلوبهم. Those are the مخبتين. So the مخبت is a person who, when the name of Allah is mentioned, his heart is trembled, it's shaken. He's too fearful to violate or to disobey or to do anything that may displease Allah. الذين إذا ذكر الله وجلت قلوبهم, that is one kind of إخبات. And والصابرين على ما أصابهم. So to be patient whenever you are afflicted with any harm or test or trial is also part of إخبات, submission and humility. والمقيم الصلاة. الصلاة which has ركوع and سجود, two forms of humility which is one sign of إخبات. So إقامة الصلاة is described here and listed as one description of إخبات. وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. And from whatever we provided them, they spend. They spend in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إخبات also includes humility not only before Allah, but also humility with people. That a مخبت and an arrogant person cannot be one and the same. Arrogance is the opposite of humility and submission. والبدنة, ayah number 36, جعلناها لكم من شعائر الله. البدن هي سمين البقر, the fat cows. When the cow carries a lot of meat, it also carries a lot of fat. So in the Arabic language, they call it badina or budna. Al-budn is the plural of budna or badana, which means heavy body cow. والبدن جعلناها لكم من شعائر الله. So part of the rituals is to sacrifice those cows as instructed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَكُمْ فِيهَا خَيْرٌ. It has a lot of good things for you. You know that we benefit, and I will let Dr. Noor, if you please, explain to us what are the kind of benefits that we benefit from cows, their flesh, their meat, their skin, everything, if you please.
Their milk, their meat, their leather, some of them their hair, all these are benefits. Also other benefit is some of the animals we use it for transport and so on and so forth. And all these are mentioned in the Quran, in other surahs and also in the surah. Thank you.
So we mentioned al-budn as fat cows. Al-budn also could be fat she camels in particular, because they are also a source of, huge source of milk, very special kind of milk and meat. لَكُمْ فِيهَا خَيْرَ. There's a lot of good for you in it. فَاذْكُرُوا اسْمَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهَا صَوَاف. When you stand it to slaughter it, because those are not slaughtered normally, they are slaughtered by what is called nahr. And nahr huwa that you stab the animal in a specific place in the neck, whether it is a she camel or a camel, and they would be standing as you do that. But you have to be very accurate and very precise to hit the place where they cannot run and create chaos. So they are slaughtered standing, and they are tied. So you get them standing on three legs and you tie the fourth together so that they cannot run. فَإِذَا وَجَبَتْ جُنُوبُهَا. When they fall on their side. فَكُلُوا مِنْهَا. Which means they have already been killed by the way of nahr, then they are ready to be cut into pieces. وَجَبَتْ جُنُوبُهَا. They fell on their side. فَكُلُوا مِنْهَا وَأَطْعِمُوا الْقَانِعَ وَالْمُعْتَرَ. You feed the poor, which is one type of people. والمعتر, this is the person who has nothing. So al-faqir may have something, but al-mu'tar, he has nothing, which is what you call the person who only gets his needs fulfilled by asking. From it comes the word عَرَى وَعَتَرَى وَعَارِيَةَ. العارية is something that you borrow or you lend. Okay? So المعتر هو السائل الذي يقضي حاجته بالسؤال. كَذَلِكَ سَخَّرْنَاهَا لَكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. And as such, we have subjected those huge animals to you. You know that a wolf is much smaller in size than a cow or a camel. But can a child play with a wolf or fox? They can't. But they can take a camel by the rope and put him or her in the barn and tie them, and they would oblige. Who made them oblige to the child? Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. كذلك سخرناها لكم. In such a way we have subjected, made them obedient to you. كذلك سخرناها لكم لعلكم تشكرون, so that you may offer gratitude to Allah سبحانه وتعالى. لن ينال الله لحومها, آية number 37, the flesh or the meat of it would not reach Allah. ولكن يناله التقوى منكم. The only thing that reaches Allah of what you slaughter and sacrifice is not the sacrifice itself. It is your taqwa, that you are doing it exclusively in obedience to Allah, and you are distributing it according to His guidelines. This is taqwa. Taqwa is to protect yourself from disobeying Allah or displeasing Allah that would cause His wrath. كذلك ولكن يناله التقوى منكم كذلك سخرها لكم. And that's why Allah made it obedient to you. لتكبروا الله على ما هداكم, so that you may glorify and praise Allah and appreciate His greatness for the guidance He has provided you. And here, وَبَشِّرِ الْمُحْسِنِينَ, give good news and glad tidings to the muhsineen, those who excel and devote and do their best. Ayah number 38 moves to another subject. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُدَافِعُ عَنِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. We all repeat this part of the ayah. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُدَافِعُ عَنِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. But we really need to reflect on it. Do we really believe this? Or do we say it out of helplessness? Just because there is nothing we could do. Because there is a difference. If we do not accept it and believe it and live it, even when we can defend ourselves, Jazakallah khair. That's another form of ihsan. Jazakallah khair. If we do not believe it and live it, even when we can push back on our own behalf, then it becomes meaningless when we say it when we are helpless. And that's why it doesn't benefit much to say it, unless you truly believe it. Because with all the preparation and the means and the methods you may have at your disposal to defend against enemy attacks or fights and wars, you still should believe that it is up to Allah to defend you. وَيَوْمَ حُنَيْنَ إِذْ أَعْجَبَتْكُمْ كَثْرَتُكُمْ فَلَمْ تُغْنِ عَنْكُمْ شَيْئًا. And on the day of Hunayn, remember that you were so proud and boastful of your numbers, and the companions, some of them said, لَنْ نُهْزَمَ الْيَوْمَ مِنْ قِلَّةِ, we will not be defeated because we are not a few anymore. We are not as few as we used to be. Today is our day. فَلَمْ تُغْنِ عَنْكُمْ شَيْئًا. Your numerous elements and numbers and resources did not protect you. Who protected you? Allah. وَضَاقَتْ عَلَيْكُمُ الْأَرْضِ بِمَا رَحُبَتْ. The earth became tight under your feet, which means it is a signification of the fact that they were looking for places to run, but there were no place to run. ضاقت عليكم الأرض, there is no place. بما رحبت, when it was actually broad and vast. ثم وليتم مدبرين, and you ran away. ثم أنزل الله سكينته على رسوله وعلى المؤمنين وأيدكم بجنود لم تروها وجعل كلمة الذين كفروا السفلى وكلمة الله هي العليا. So on the day of Hunayn, when the companions thought they were too many to be defeated, they actually ran away in the battlefield until Allah sent down his calm and tranquility upon the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the believers, and he sent his support. So at the time when you are powerful, don't rely and count on your power. Continue to count on the power and the support of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُدَافِعُ عَنِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. There is a story from the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he was once sitting with Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu arda, and a Bedouin came and he seemed that he had some grievances with Abu Bakr. So he started to talk harsh to Abu Bakr and to attack him and to challenge him. And as long as he was doing this, the Prophet ﷺ was smiling and looking at the two of them. Abu Bakr is silent and the man continues the barrage of attacks and challenges, and the Prophet is smiling. So Abu Bakr felt at one point that he needs to push back. So when he started pushing back, just by clearing his position, like explaining himself, not answering tit for tat or the type of counter attack, no, just explaining himself, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam left. So Abu Bakr was wondering, what happened? So he ran after the Prophet and he said, "Oh Prophet Muhammad, when he was attacking me, you were smiling. And when I start to just explain myself, because he came with a lot of misunderstanding, I just wanted him to understand, you left?" He said, "Ya Abu Bakr, كانت الملائكة تدفع عنك وأنت في صمتك. فلما أخذت تتكلم ذهبت الملائكة ولم يكن لي أن أجلس في مجلس ذهبت عنه الملائكة." When you started talking, the angels left. You don't need their defense, so they left. And when they leave, I, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, could not continue sitting in a place where the angels left. So here you see a vivid picture of Allah sending the angels to defend a person who, out of respect for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he kept silent in the face of attack and maybe insult, maybe this, maybe that, and he kept silent out of respect. But then when he discovered that this was all based on misunderstanding and he wanted to explain, he was not paying attention to the spiritual dynamics that were going on in this meeting, that there were angels in the meeting and they were playing a role in the meeting. They were not just watching. So Abu Bakr learned after this what was going on. So إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُدَافِعُ عَنِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. I want you to take a minute and think of a situation that you have been through and you were not even in the place to defend yourself, but someone stood in your defense. In your absence. Take a minute and think about it. whether it is in your job, in your social network, in the community, in your family, that from time to time we all get misunderstood and people talk bad either to us or about us. If we trust Allah to defend us, it means a lot. It means we're not going to be very concerned about people's views, because their views is not the final judgment. Allah has a final judgment. So I am not as bad as people think. I am not as an angel as some others think. I'm somewhere in between, and Allah knows me the best. Why should I worry about people's views? So this ayah has deeper meaning than just chewing on it without thinking of its deeper meaning. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُدَافِعُ عَنِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. As this applies to the person as an individual, it applies to the community, it applies to the Muslim nation. With all of what is going on, Allah will stand in defense of the true believers. So when Allah lets a community down, or a nation, or a person, the question shouldn't be, why isn't Allah supporting him or them? The question is, did they qualify to be believers? Because once you qualify, you get this kind of help. Once you qualify as a believer, this benefit comes with the policy. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ كُلَّ خَوَّانٍ كَفُورٍ. Allah doesn't like any treasonous person who commits betrayal, whether it is betrayal to individual trust, family trust, community trust, personal secrets, private matters, what money, whatever you are entrusted with, the result of this kind of trust, either that you will be trustworthy or you will betray your trust. So the ayah is saying, Allah doesn't like anyone whose life is signified by betraying trust. The word khawan, ala wazn fa'al, it means that his betrayal has turned into a character trait, like the difference between kathib and kathab. Kathib is someone who lied once or twice, but kathab means it's a character trait. It's part of the character of the person. Also, it can come as a profession, meaning when you say sana'a shay'an is different from saying he is a najjar, haddad. That is his sana'a, that is his profession. But someone who works with iron once is not haddad. Someone who fixes a chair at home is not najjar. So it takes deep and long lasting practice to turn the person into fa'al, kathab, khawan, najjar. The following ayah, ayah number 39, as Allah says that He defends the believers, it doesn't mean that the believers should do nothing in self-defense. So ayah 39 says, أذن للذين يقاتلون بأنهم ظلموا. The decision, the permission and the command has been given and made to those who have been fought against. To do what? That they have been wronged. Allah has already decided that they have been wronged means they have been wronged for long. وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى نَصْرِهِمْ لَقَدِيرٌ. And Allah is capable of giving them support and victory. This ayah comes years after the community left the persecution of Mecca. You know that Muslims were harshly and badly persecuted in Mecca, and they were tormented, they were subjected to inflicting pain and torture. And we know stories about companions, individuals and groups that were punished and tortured for their faith. When they moved to Medina and the kuffar were still amassing around the Medina to scare them that we can come back, we can follow you, we can obliterate you, we can destroy you still. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the permission to the believers to start preparing. So what was the situation in Mecca? In Mecca, the Quran describes the situation of the believers as follows. وَذْكُرُوا إِذْ أَنْتُمْ قَلِيلٌ إِذْ أَنْتُمْ قَلِيلٌ مستضعفون كنتم أو أنتم أحمد أنتم واذكروا إذ أنتم قليل مستضعفون في الأرض تخافون أن يتخطفكم الناس. You see the description here, and remember that you were few, your number was small number, helpless, مستضعفون, you were taking advantage of. Many of you were slaves. تخافون أن يتخطفكم الناس. People were afraid to pray in the Kaaba for fear of the disbelievers, the idol worshippers, coming and attacking them physically or killing them. So they would not pray in the Kaaba for years. تخافون أن يتخطفكم الناس. You were afraid that people will snatch you and hurt you. فآواكم. Allah provided you with a shelter, a place where you are safe and secure, that is in Medina. فآواكم وأيدكم بنصره, and he supported you. ورزقكم من الطيبات, and many of you built wealth, and Allah provided for you. In those days, the early days in Mecca, Muslims were living under severe persecution for a period of 13 long years. In those years, Allah sent them what to do. He told them, كفوا أيديكم وأقيموا الصلاة. Hold on your hands. Don't extend a hand of punishment against the attacks that you get. And it is an amazing detailed instruction. The ayah doesn't say just don't answer. The ayah says, كفوا أيديكم, which means hold your fast, hold your hand. Do not extend your hand of punishment to others. كفوا أيديكم. كفوا أيديكم also could mean spread your kaf, which means to spread a hand of peaceful relationship, even to those who are still persecuting you. Reach out to them, reach out to, these are your relatives, these are your kin and tribes and families. Reach out to them. كفوا أيديكم وأقيموا الصلاة and establish prayer. But when they went to Medina, and the challenge and the threats of attack continued, even after many of them left in Mecca behind them, when they were leaving, they left their money, they left some of their families, they left their possessions and their properties to be taken by the disbelievers. We know the story of Suhaib ibn Sinan al-Rumi, a young, wealthy companion who made money and he had wealth. And when he believed and wanted to join the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, leaving Mecca to go to Medina, they stopped him. And they told him, we're not going to let you go. And he knew that they were after his money. So he told them, if I tell you where my money is, would you let me go? They said, yes. So he told them where his money was saved. So they took his money, they left him. When he arrived in Medina, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam received him saying, رَبِحَ الْبَيْعُ أَبَا يَحْيَى, the deal you have won. This is a good deal you engaged in. It's a good deal you had. And you are a winner in that deal. That's only one example. There is the example of Abu Talha, whom they took his child and they kept pulling the child back and forth until his arm became loose at the shoulder. Dislocation because of the fight over the kid. And he left his son, and with that he also left his wife. So there are stories of how serious and severe the persecution is. I am detailing this because some people think that the Meccan period is already over. It was then. But Muslims now should never think like being in Mecca. But Mecca and the Meccan period was not dealt with in this way because of the place, but because of the conditions under which Muslims lived, which means a very important principle. Whenever the conditions repeat themselves, Muslims need to follow the same rules. So there is no such a thing as making a small band of people an army on behalf of the Ummah. This is as ridiculous as it can get. But this is not a subject we can fully cover now. But I just wanted to give you an idea that when Muslims are seriously and severely persecuted and they are too helpless, then this condition invokes immediately certain other triggers and automatic things that should happen. Number one, those surrounding able communities should rush to support them and help them. We Muslims do not only help oppressed Muslims, but if Muslims were the oppressor, we are still called to stand against oppression. Even if the oppressed is non-Muslim and the oppressor is a Muslim, we stand against oppressors who are Muslims the same way we stand against oppressors and tyrants who are not Muslims. That issue has to be clear. We don't fight people for their faith. We would be nuts. We would be crazy to do that. And this is not a personal opinion. This is what the Quran is saying. The Quran is telling us that the majority of people, no matter what you do, will never believe. وَمَا أَكْثَرُ النَّاسِ وَلَوْ حَرَصْتَ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ So how would Allah want us to fight everybody there is based on their faith? There is not a single ayah in the Quran that tells Muslims to fight people just because they believe differently. All the ayat refer to aggression and defense against aggression and pushing back against attack, occupation, manipulation, tyranny and oppression, injustice and wrongdoing, but not because somebody believes differently. Here, the permission, ayah number 39, أُذِنَ لِلَّذِينَ يُقَاتَلُونَ بِأَنَّهُمْ ظُلِمُوا. The permission and the decision has been made that they have been wronged for a long time, which was understood clearly by Muslims, that this permission means the permission to fight back against attacks and threats of attacks. وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ نَصْرِهِمْ لَقَدِيرٌ Allah is capable of giving them support and victory. Who are those people? الَّذِينَ أُخْرِجُوا مِنْ دِيَارِهِمْ بِغَيْرِ حَقٍّ Those who have been expelled and driven out of their homeland for no rightful reason. إِلَّا أَن يَقُولُوا رَبُّنَ اللَّهِ The only reason was that they said, Our Lord is Allah. Our God, our Master is Allah. Then the famous rule, وَلَوْلَا دَفْعُ اللَّهِ النَّاسَ بَعْضَهُمْ بِبَعْضٍ لَهُدِّمَتْ صَوَامِعُ وَبِيَعٌ وَصَلَوَاتٌ وَمَسَاجِدُ يُذْكَرُ فِيهَا اسْمُ اللَّهِ كَثِيرًا Were it not for Allah pushing people against each other, monasteries would have been destroyed, markets would have been destroyed, prayer places would have been destroyed, places of worship would have been destroyed, mosques would have been destroyed. Amazing. In ayah number 38, it stated that Allah defends all the believers. In ayah 39, it says permission is given for you to push back. In ayah 40, here Allah is saying push back because that is how Allah executes His will by pushing people against each other. In other words, Allah can provide unilateral, unique support, but He is going to give it to those who prepare whatever means of power they have, and they engage in pushing back against aggression, attack, occupation, and manipulation. وَلَيَنْصُرَنَّ اللَّهُ مَنْ يَنْصُرُهُ Allah will support and give victory to those who support His cause, those who support His guidance, those who follow and obey His commands. إن الله لقوي. الله is most certainly powerful. عزيز. He is immune. Nobody could affect or influence Allah in any way. Allah will do what Allah wants to do. His will be done. Allah غالب على أمره. But he says, وَلَيَنْصُرَنَّ اللَّهُ مَنْ يَنْصُرُهُ. If you want Allah's support, you have to support the cause of Allah, and you have to be willing to engage in pushing against injustices, wrongdoing, corruption, mischief, and all forms of oppression and repression. We'll stop at ayah number 40, inshallah, and we'll continue, inshallah, next week. Subhanak Allahumma wa bihamdik. نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك.